So this part of the introductory tutorial is devoted to a specific context of argumentation, a certain very interesting subdomain, which is legal argumentation, taken from a very specific angle, namely the research on AI in law. So, Marty rightly emphasized that it is important in argumentation who is speaking to whom. I will introduce myself briefly. I work at Jagiellonian University in the Department of Legal Theory, where the application of AI tools to modeling of legal argumentation is my main topic of research. And in parallel, I happen to be a legal advisor. So I'm admitted to practice in Poland, I practice law. This gives very interesting insights into how the theoretical tools may be applied in real practice during the negotiations in the courtroom, and how legal cases may inspire theoretical reflection on legal argumentation. So, how many of you are lawyers? Okay, computer scientists. Okay, so the majority of you are computer scientists. So I hope that you will learn something new about legal argumentation during this introductory tutorial. And I'm also pleased to announce that a very good colleague of mine, Floris Bex, will deliver the advanced tutorials on this topic on Saturday and Sunday. Let's move on. Legal argumentation. So we know legal argumentation from movies, from novels. But what is the reality of this? We have this image of a very charismatic lawyer arguing in a courtroom, for instance, with cross-examination of a witness, or trying to persuade the jury to adopt a certain decision. However, the reality of legal argumentation is much broader, and I would say much more down to earth. So basically, legal argumentation is a process of arguing for and against legal answers to legal questions, and it is ubiquitous in legal reasoning. Sometimes even a little boring, but it's ubiquitous. Since the 1950s of the 20th century, the argumentative approach to law is a very strong paradigm in legal theory. Before that, the theoretical reflection of on legal reasoning was mainly influenced by legal positivism. The 19th century legal positivism was a theory of law according to which legal thinking was mainly conceptual and to a very large extent constrained and necessary. In 20th century we realized and discovered what was in practice obvious for Roman lawyers in ancient law, that the law is essentially argumentative. For instance, the work of Haim Perelman from 1950s and 1960s was a groundbreaking work because it offered a theory of audience to legal theory. That legal reasoning is essentially about persuading the relevant audience to accept certain statements. It was a very strong point made by Perelman. It was called new rhetoric. Then in 1970s and 1980s, German philosopher of law, Robert Alexey, perhaps one of the most famous legal theorists in the world, developed the so-called procedural theory of legal argumentation, which emphasized the rules of fairness in the process of exchanging arguments. In the 21st century, this is perhaps the strongest approach to the analysis, to the research on legal reasoning. People like Manuel Atienza, Spanish legal philosopher, claim that law is essentially argumentation. He's an author of the book Derecho a la Argumentación. IAAIL, on the other hand, it is an interdisciplinary field which is concerned application of information technology tools that could support lawyers in their activities, that could emulate legal reasoning, or which use law as an illustrative domain. For our tutorial, and I believe that also for Floris, the most important issue here is the second field, that computer programs are developed to emulate, simulate legal reasoning, in particular argumentation. Of course, we have the general question, what is AI? As computer scientists gathered, you perhaps know much more on this topic than I, but I think that we are all aware that the answer to this question is changing over time. So, in the early accounts developed in the times of John McCarthy and Martin Minsky, we are expecting AI to be a computer program that would draw conclusions from the data sets. And the first programs that were claimed to be AI were performing exactly this task. As we all know, there were great expectations and times of hype in the research of AI, and there were also periods of a cold winter. Nowadays, we think that we are witnessing another hype period because of the explosion of the research on machine learning and deep learning. I think that we have already accustomed to the word AI, not in a, you know, a science fiction sense, but in a very down-to-earth sense. We just speak to each other that we have AI on the computer, that my AI is doing something and his AI is doing something else. Of course, these computer programs are not the conscient entities as depicted in novels and movies, but nowadays it's quite intuitive for us to claim that certain computer programs are AIs. And of course, there is this vision of super intelligence depicted by Nick Bostrom and others, that's Stephen Hawking. It's quite afraid of this perspective that at a certain point in time a special entity will emerge that will surpass us with respect to intelligence and possible energy. And of course we have to take into account these three perspectives while thinking about legal reasoning in AI and law. The basic question I would like you to focus on during this introductory tutorial is what is and what is not algorithmic in legal argumentation? Or in other words, can legal reasoning and legal argumentation be reduced to or presented as an algorithm? Well, an algorithm is a broad concept. We have dozens of types of algorithms. Some of them may be extremely complex, but the feedback phase, defining feature of an algorithm is that this procedure should be well defined. It may be very complex in many matters, it may be probabilistic, encompass chaotic equations and so on, but it has to be well defined. And then, if something is not algorithmical in legal reasoning, then what it is? That's a very good question, because this should be a kind of natural limit to development of AI tools and simulated legal reasoning. As a point of departure, let us present the so-called legal syllogism. It is based on the work of Aristotle. We have a major premise, this is the so-called non-ethic premise, which, and this is typically a rule. So, for instance, vehicles are prohibited from entering the public park. This, by the way, will be our leading case we'll try to analyze by thinking what can and what cannot be put into an algorithmic account. We have my premise that my Serena is a vehicle. Serena is a type of cars produced in Poland in the 50s, 60s, and also 70s. And as a siren is a symbol of Warsaw, and we are here in Warsaw, then with this car as an example. As a conclusion, my Serena is prohibited from entering the public park. Of course, this is a simplification. In fact, I am prohibited from entering the public park in my Serena, but I think that is pretty much straightforward. Anyway, this is Serena. Okay. By the way, is it a convincing argument? You go to a lawyer interested whether you can enter the public park in Warsaw in your Serena. So assuming that the norm presented to you is a part of valid law, you receive this piece of information. Persuasive? Yes, indeed. Algorithmic? Pretty much, yes. Provided that we know that Serena is available, but it is. It seems that we have no problems. Either with accepting the concluding statement argument and also from putting this type of reasoning into a computer program. It's very interesting. We already know that. Is legal syllogism deductive? It depends. Because as you can see, this reasoning is presented in a natural language and it is a kind of non-trivial task going from this representation of this reasoning to a representation by means of which we can conclude that it is a deductive inference, but intuitively it is. What are the problems that we will have to take into account while formalizing legal reasoning making computational? So this norm may be in conflict with other norms in legal system. We have to take it into account. We have to deal with the problem of open texture. We'll discuss it in one of the next slides. And there are also important legal principles that may have some influence on our routine. Finally, we have to fix the validity problem first. So in our legal syllogism, we assume that it is a valid law that vehicles are prohibited from the public park. But how can we know that? How can we know that? So let's begin with normative components. Let's assume that we have this norm, vehicles are prohibited from entering the public park, but on the other hand, we have another norm that ambulances are allowed to enter the public park, which is, by the way, quite a reasonable rule. It's quite probable that somebody will need help in this public park. So how should this conflict be solved? Because apparently, ambulance is a vehicle. So it seems to lead to an inconsistency, which is of course a problem for classical logicians. So how should this reason be presented in a computer program? Believe me or not, people were actually trying to apply classical logic to represent the law, to begin with the work of Ulrich Krug in the 1950s. And this was a kind of popular paradigm in the middle of the 20th century. Here we have a simplistic representation of a combined rule. But if something is a vehicle and it is not an ambulance, it is prohibited from entering the public park. So in a way, in this formalization, an exception was incorporated into the rule, and we don't obtain a consistency. Of course, there is a simplification in the conclusion, because then we have a deontic operator prohibited, but for the sake of simplicity, I just use the predicate P, which means that, which is a huge predicate, you prohibited from entering the public park. Alright, so this is of course proper formalization, first of the logic, but what is wrong with that? What can possibly be wrong with that? Here we have another example, the tram. This was a car quite similar, similar to Serena, that was produced in Eastern Germany during similar times. So we can conclude that Trabant is a vehicle, but it is not an ambulance. So it is prohibited from entering. Now, what is good in this model? It is deductive. So we are, in a way, released from further thinking, provided that we can prove that we have true premises, we will obtain a true conclusion. And this is very comforting. The law speaks for itself. It seems to be less important who is speaking. And the relevant audience also seems quite irrelevant in this respect. The law speaks for itself, it's objective, it's neutral, it's impartial. All right. But what are the problems? The problem is that, in fact, perhaps we have two rules here, and not a combined one. In reality, we have to make a kind of inference step to realize that the second rule is an exception from the first. But there is a more serious problem. We have already incorporated only one exception into our rule, but there may be further ones. There may be more normative conflicts. Some exceptions may be implicit only, and we will have to discover them. So here, divisible logics designed to model non-monotonic reasoning enter the field in 1980s. We have two rules. If something is a vehicle, it is prohibited from entering the public park. This is the first rule. And the second rule, if something is an ambulance, it is allowed to enter the public park. And in order to make our reasoning inclusive, we have to state that the second rule has priority over the first one. The question is, how do we determine this priority? not be given by the text of statutes itself. Well, we have to determine the priorities by means of our reasoning. Here, any hints? What could be the reason for adopting this ordering? Well, it's again obvious, it's very reasonable, but what is the justification? I think we can provide twofold answers to this question. So the first answer would be a formal one, that ambulance is a more specific concept than menu. So the priority would be assigned here on the grounds of specificity. Let us take a look that if we adopted another ordering here, the second rule will be completely redundant. It would make no sense but there is also a substantial argument for this, namely ambulances are used to save people's lives and life is a very important value. Perhaps in a typical situation it is more important the values that are assigned to an institution of public parks. What are values that justify the very existence of public parks? Relaxation, yes. Error, perhaps. Alright, so we need to have life to enjoy this, which is an argument that this second rule should have as priority. There are many people that commence their careers in the 1980s, especially the concluding part of this decade. Giovanni Sarko, Henry Bracke, Martin Heidegger, later, Marek Sergot, a little earlier, who devoted much of their time and energy for representing huge portions of legal reasoning by means of different types of divisible algebra. During the 1980s, the idea of legal expert systems has become very prominent. In certain circles, a legal expert system is basically a set of rules that represent knowledge, and we have an inference engine. Typically, those legal expert systems were programmed in Prolog, and they were answering simple questions asked by users. They were also handling context of rules quite well. And, perhaps the most famous project of this type developed in 1986 was logical implementation of British National Act, which was performed by Marek Sergot, Robert Kowalski, and their research team. Let us now assume that we have a little more complicated case than the case of ambulance. But imagine that you are driving your Serena and you have to take your ill aunt to the hospital. Are you allowed to enter the public park? Let's assume that the path through the public park is the shortest one to the hospital. Otherwise, you will have to make a really great circle to get there in a traffic jam. 3 hours. Are you allowed to enter the public park or not? Now, perhaps there is no rule in the legal system according to which if you are driving with your ill aunt on board, you are allowed to enter the public park. The legislator is not that specific. But typically in legal systems we have the notion of state of necessity. If you are in a state of necessity, then you are typically allowed to commit acts that are otherwise forbidden. So, for instance, you might destroy someone's property if you are in a state of necessity. Now the question is whether you are allowed to enter the public park with your new aunt on board. And this is non-trivial. Because we had, in the ambulance case, we knew ambulance is an ambulance. But it is legally defined what an ambulance is. I can't paint my sirena into red and white and claim that it is an ambulance. This would be an ineffective institutional act, so to say. But state of necessity is a kind of open concept, and you have to apply it to a concrete situation. So what determines that you are in a state of necessity? And here, another part of AI research, and this will be seen in case-based reasoning and teleological reasoning. Case-based reasoning modeling uses the notion of factors. Factors are stereotypical fact patterns that enable us to argue for or against a certain outcome. An important thing about factors is that they do not determine the outcome. They are just reasons for or against. They are even weaker than default rules. What factors should we determine in the EOM case in order to argue for the solution that we are allowed to enter the public park? Well, if there would be a convenient other way to the hospital, then perhaps would not have a good reason to enter the park. But if the alternative path is very long and often jammed, then perhaps this would be a factor leading to a conclusion that we actually were in a state of necessity. Because were not entering the public park, then perhaps it would lead to a medical problem of our hands, an endangerment of our health or even life. The type of the condition our aunt has is another factor that has to be taken into account. Because if she has a sore throat, then perhaps it is no reason at all to enter the public park in the medical. Can wait. Of course, it's not pleasant to have a sore throat. Perhaps it's not even a reasonable to go to the hospital. But if she's having a heart attack or cardiac arrest, perhaps it's an important factor to consider. The other side of this coin is theological reasoning, which consists in identifying either relevant values and interpreting the law in light of its values. So if we were to interpret the notion of state of necessity theologically, I think we would very quickly identify the human life and health as an important value, which would quickly lead us to the conclusion that in this certain context we might be in state of necessity. There are many people working on case-based reasoning and logical reasoning. Kevin Ashley and Edwin Risland were pioneers of this approach in AI and law in the 1980s. Trevor Grange Capon from Liverpool also contributed very seriously to this line of research. So far, we have not considered the question what is vehicle. We knew that an ambulance is a vehicle, that a sirena or truck is a vehicle. But let us consider whether a motorbike is a vehicle. Are we allowed to enter the public park on a motorbike? Okay. The lawyer will immediately say, okay, we have to look up for a definition. And if we have a definition in a bill and it is well drafted, then it's of course helpful. But sometimes it is poorly drafted and we have to interpret it nevertheless, and sometimes there is no definition. So a vehicle is a vehicle and deal with it. So bicycle. A tank, which is at the same time being a historical monument. We want to commemorate something important in this public park. Are you allowed to enter the park with this tank? Of course. In 19th century, ladies and gentlemen, when there were no traffic laws, lawyers used analogy from horses, newly developed cars. Horse traffic acts were quite extensive, so they actually applied this analogy. So, nowadays, would we consider a horse a vehicle? Perhaps not. But are we allowed to enter the public park on a horse and gallop? Perhaps no, but why? Because we may draw an analogical inference from the paradigmatic example of a vehicle or a horse, that a horse also has a kind of capacity of disturb the people that want to enjoy silence and fresh air in the public park. So here again, theological reasoning comes into force. And this is very important, because if we are developing a knowledge base for legal reasoning, we very often have to deal with concepts with blurred boundaries. And even the concepts that appear to be very unequivocal and obvious at a certain point of time may not be that obvious after 10 years. So for many centuries the concept of mother was quite unequivocal. But taking into account the recent developments in biotechnology, this concept became a little shaky in law. The classical definition of a mother is a woman that who gave a child a childbirth. But nowadays it is possible technically that another woman is giving a child a childbirth and another is, so to say, the giver of biological material. So, this is an important incident. So far, we have focused mainly on how should we represent legal knowledge in computer systems, and of course, this is a necessary starting point, because if we want to embed legal argumentation, we have to have some sources from which we argue. But how to represent the argumentation itself? We have two very influential approaches to this problem. The first one is an abstract argumentation, which is developed in the branch of research referred to as abstract argumentation frameworks. In the simplest form, we begin with two primitives. That is the notion of argument and attack, which is a binary relation defined in the sets of arguments. Then we define the so-called semantics. The semantics are a set of criteria that generate justified or acceptable subsets of arguments, and these generated subsets are eventually referred to as extensions. That's what Fanon and Blum are famous for introducing this simple but very persuasive in the 1990s. This formalism enables graphs represent attack relations and the nodes are arguments. So, taking into account the adapted semantics, we may generate the answers to questions for these. And of course, these semantics may be very different. The advantage of this formalism is that it is simple and shows us the structure, or the metastructure of argumentation. So it shows what is attacked by what in a given sample of argumentation. It's also computationally tractable, so it's important again. The disadvantage of this abstract approach is that we do not dig into the structure of arguments. So we have to simply assume that certain pieces of language are arguments, and we have to assume that certain arguments attack other arguments. So, of course, it's also possible, and it's being done, to take into account structure of argumentation. Here we formalize premises, conclusions, and relations between them. And we have many systems related to AI and law research that deal with structures of argumentation. To mention Carniaris in SP Plus, the first program developed in cooperation of Tom Gordon and Douglas Walton. By the way, both gentlemen will be present at the METAR workshop on next Saturday, the course of Argumentation Week, so that's a good occasion. SP Plus is a program developed by Henry Bracken and his collaborators. So there is an important connection here with the talk presented by Marcin, because structured argumentation may be very well understood in terms of argumentation schemes, because argumentation schemes are precisely the tools that give you insights into how arguments are constructed and how they can be attacked and on what grounds. Carniaris also enables us to present argumentation in the form of graphs, and these graphs show you the structure of argumentation. In boxes, we have propositional content, that is the premises and conclusions of argumentation, and the circles represent argumentation nodes, that there is some kind of reasoning pattern that enable us to go from a premise to a conclusion. If there is such a connection, then we highlight it in green. If there is no such connection, it's highlighted in red. All right. So far so good. We already know that during the last several decades in the world of AI and law, we have learned not only how to represent the content of legal regulation, even though it is still controversial subject to debate, but also how to represent certain patterns of reasoning that are to be found there, and contemporary computer argumentation systems, they encompass rule-based reasoning, phase-based reasoning, and theological value-based reasoning in order to provide the user with justification for adoption of certain legal conclusions. Let us try to reconsider our vehicle in the park case to reflect briefly on whether we are already there. So this research has been done. We know how to represent different types of legal arguments in computer systems. Well, then, why I am here? And so why are fellow colleagues lawyers still in the society? Why is it not so that we just download an app on our mobile phone and then consult for legal answers? The question is enter public park with my sirena, because otherwise I will be late for work. Imagine that you are a lawyer and your client is asking you this question. For me, it is important not to be late for work. Can I go for the public park in order to avoid this? Perhaps there is no such explicit rule in the legal system, but I can argue that it is an important value for me not to be late for work. So perhaps our interpretation of legal rules should be adjusted accordingly. Well, our intuitive answer to this question perhaps is no. But why? Because we have common knowledge that it is generally possible for people to wake up a little earlier and not to be late for work, taking into account standard paths altogether. But how can a computer program know this? It is a part of societal life. Let us refine our case a little bit. Let's add to this that I am a surgeon. Can I go for the public park because otherwise I will be late for work? I'm a surgeon. If I don't cross the public park, I will be late. I'm a surgeon. Well, maybe your presence in work may be important for somebody. But today I don't perform surgeries. Another piece of information. Okay, so perhaps we should implement into our computer program some knowledge that it is important for surgeons not to be late for work. But the mere fact that they are surgeons is perhaps not a sufficient condition for this conclusion. Actually, performing surgeries is another important factor. But I consult another surgeon who is performing. But on the other hand, he is quite independent and well-trained. But needs my presence to feel more convenient. As you can see, we can develop this case. And it is, of course, the task of the lawyer to ask the client so many important questions about the circumstances of the case. So now there is a question of knowledge acquisition problems. How can a computer program know all of that? We already know, and the long development of the system science that was initiated in the 1980s to encapsulate common sense reasoning in AI, it's a little discouraging. So it's very time consuming to explicitly enter common sense reasoning rules into computer programs. And as you can see, they are very necessary for legal reasoning. One answer discussed during the last decades, one decade, is machine learning. So that we should just mine the vast ocean of information that is there on the web to make our computer program aware what is actually important for the people and what is not in certain contexts and in which contexts. However, the problem is that statistical mechanisms that are used in machine learning techniques by themselves cannot give us a justification for an answer. They can just give us some statistical information. We can improve the performance with regard to different different criteria such as precision, recall, memory, and so on, but they won't give us the justification. So this is the scene we are on currently. I would like to point out your attention to advanced tutorial. Instead of a conclusion, we have to research what can be transformed into an algorithm. We already knew that huge parts of legal reasoning may be taking into account different approaches to knowledge representation. But perhaps the greatest problem is with common sense reasoning and its acquisition and